Welcome back. So in the last class, we started discussing about scalar couplings. I introduced you about the mechanism of scalar coupling without going more into the detailed theory mechanism. And afterwards, I started telling you various salient points that you must remember as far as the scalar couplings are concerned. Several points I mentioned. Of course, when I came to this point, I was almost, things were getting late, so I had to go in a hurry. Let me repeat it here, especially these two points. I said when one spin or one proton is coupled to other chemically inequivalent nuclear spins, there is going to be multiplicity of the peaks. I said in the previous slide, if you remember, I said here, here it is said one peak can become 2, 2 can become 4, 4 can become 8. This is what I said. This is because multiplicity is arising because one spin can interact with this and makes it to a 2. Another will make this to 4. Like, we'll understand the splitting pattern later. Lot more things to discuss about these things. We'll come to that later. But what I wanted to tell you is, especially when you have chemically inequivalent spin, there can be multiplicity, but we can give that by a simple expression called 2ni plus 1. N is the number of protons or the number of spins which are in the equivalent group. For example, if I take Ca3, all the three protons are equivalent in the group of Ca3. If I take N is 3, what is proton spin? I is equal to half. Then you have to just plug in the value of spin and the number of protons in that group of equivalent spins. For example, if CH2, N is 2, like that. If it is CH4, N is 4, like that. This is the simple formula to understand the multiplicity. We will discuss that later. Okay. Another important point for coupling among the equivalent spins, if I see this coupling, here in the previous example, I showed you intensity 1 becomes 2, 2 becomes 4, 4 becomes 8, like that. Then what is happening every time? Intensity is same. 1 is to 1, it becomes half, again 1 is to 1, again half. So like that, whatever the splitting pattern, but each line will have the same intensity. First it is 1, then it will become half of equal intensity, again 4 of equal intensity, then 8 of equal intensity. That is when they are chemically inequivalent spins. They are individual spins. Now, for the chemically equivalent group of spins, this is the formula for multiplicity. But for the intensity of them, it is not just 1 is to 1. It goes by what is called Pascal triangle or coefficients of binomial expansion. This is the point which we will discuss today. Mostly, I will teach you what it is, why it is happening and everything. So, before we go proceed further, we have to talk about J-split energy states. It's very important to understand the multiplicity pattern. When two spins are interacting, I said one will become two lines. Why? Because the coupled spin will ensure this energy level is split. Similarly, this coupled spin will ensure this spin, its energy level is split. How it is splitting? This is another important point you should understand. The energy states are split because of the J coupling, and we can understand the transitions, how it is coming, why multiplicity is coming. Very classically, very easily you can understand these things. We'll go into this. Okay. Now, consider a situation when there are chemically non-equivalent spins are there with coupling states of J, there will be splitting of energy levels. Always. How does energy level shift? We'll come to that neighbor. This depends upon the number of spins it is coupled to. Remember, if it is coupled to 1, it is 2 lines. If it is coupled to 3, more, 4, like that. We will take all those examples and see how the multiplicity pattern comes at respective speeds. This is a point. Please remember, the energy level is going to be split between two coupled spins. That number of spins, number of splittings depend upon how many spins it is coupled to, and we can understand the multiplicity pattern. Start with a simple example. Now, if there is a single spin, how many possible orientations of magnetic moment are there? You all know. You have been discussing. There are only two possible orientations of spin. Upstate or downstate. Alpha state or beta state. That's what we have been discussing. Right from the day one, I discussed this. There are two possible spin states for spin of nuclei. Okay. Now, let us say this is for one spin. I have two spins, let us say. For interaction to take place, there must be two spins. One spin cannot interact with itself. So it cannot interact with itself. So we'll have two spins. Consider spin one. What are the possible states for the spin one? Two states, alpha and beta. Take spin two. What are the possible states? Again two, alpha, beta. Spin one has alpha and beta. But is it just simple two spins here, two states here? And two states here. When there are two spins, each spin has two spin states. Now the point comes like this. I am qualitatively giving you idea about spinning, splitting mechanism. Please understand this. I am discussing about the splitting mechanism now. Consider this proton A. And I am not worried about the hypothetical molecule. I am not worried about what are attached here. And about the different valences of carbon, it could be X, Y, Z, different attachments. But as far as my understanding of the splitting is concerned, I consider only two protons separated by three covalent bonds. Consider the proton A, which is highlighted in red color in the circle, which is coupled to through covalent bond proton X. This is highlighted in blue color in the circle. Now it is in a magnetic field B naught. Now you have taken the sample, put your sample in a magnetic field, external magnetic field, huge magnetic field, to observe NMR. What is going to happen? I said in the previous slide, each spin has two orientations, alpha and beta. Now proton A sees proton blue in two spin states, alpha and beta. What about proton X? That also will see proton A in two spin states. So, each of them has two spin states, plus alpha state with lower energy and beta state, which is minus half, which has a higher energy. Each spin sees this in two energy states, plus half and minus half, alpha and beta, two different energy states. One has higher energy, one has lower energy. So, it sees in two energy states. So, that means it is not seeing one magnetic field, which is two different things. Similarly, this one also split this into two energy states. So, how many you have? Each spin sees the two spin states of other spins. Then, what are the possible combinations? Why four states will come? Each one will see two, this will take three. So, in principle, if I have two spins, this spin will see this spin in two energy states, this spin will see this in two energy states. Totally, how many energy states are there? There are four. But what is the energy of each of these states? When it is one, you know it is half and minus half. When this is this spin, when it is seeing this, you know it is plus half and minus half. When both are combining together, it is not just half and half. Okay? There is a different way to calculate. Let us consider four possible combinations of all the spin states to define the energy, okay, of each of these four magnetic states. Please follow me. Now let us understand spin state to discuss the energy for all the four possible energy states. What are the four possible combinations of the spins? First, both the spins, alpha 1 and alpha 2, 1 and 2 spins, both can be up. There's one combination. Remember, both can be up like this. One combination. Spin 1 can be up, spin 2 can be down. It is like this. That's possible. Another energy state. Spin 1 can be down, spin 2 can be up. That's another possibility. One more possibility is both can be down like this. So, there are four possible combinations. Each spin, when they see other spin in plus half and minus half state, when you take the combination of all these four, this thing, there are four different energy states. Alpha, alpha beta, beta alpha, beta beta, four possible energy states. Now this magnetic energy of these states you can calculate. How do you calculate? Very simple. In this case, this is plus of, this is plus of. Simple addition. What is the total this thing? For state 1, energy state, both are half-half. That is alpha-alpha. You have to, this is the magnetic state of A spin plus half. For X spin, both half-half, like this. Both are up-up. Then you have to, for the total magnetic quantum number of this energy state, total M, if you want to find out, you would add M of A and M of X. Half plus half, you add up. What are you getting? 1. So for one energy state, the total energy, total magnetic quantum number, or total magnetic energy for this is plus half plus half. Take another energy state, second one, plus half and minus half. If you add up these two, 0. Fine. Take the another energy state, 3. This is minus half, this is plus half. So total magnetic energy is 0. Fz, that is sum of mz a plus fzx. Okay. Total magnetic moment along z axis for this a spin and this spin, if you take the total, this thing, it is 0. Now, for the energy state 4, the magnetic moment of this is minus half. This is also minus half. Take the sum of this, it is minus 1. Minus half plus minus half is minus 1. So, in the last column, I am writing Fz. Fz is nothing but the sum of the magnetic quantum numbers of each energy state. Each energy state. Each energy state here, plus half, minus half, minus half. So, this is the energy. Now, you should not consider as individually plus half, minus half. No. Take the combination. Now there are four different energy states for two couple spins. Very interesting, isn't that? How we arrived at four energy states. Now we will write down the energy level diagram, how it comes. This is all essential to understand, so that you know how the transitions occur, how the peaks come when two protons are coupled. You must know. For this, you must know how the energy level comes. So I will write down the energy levels for homo and heteronuclear spins now. For homonuclear spin, this is the energy level. Very interesting. Why? Look at this. Both are down, minus 1. It is a higher energy. Because E equal to minus mu dot B naught. In this case, both are negative. So, it will be minus 1 into B naught. So, this is higher energy. So, that is why this spin down states is always higher energy according to energy level diagram. So, it is written here. What is this magnetic energy state? What is this MZ here? Total minus half, this is minus 1. This state has total magnetic moment of minus 1. What about this state? 0. MZ, total MZA plus MZX is 0. Or MZ1 plus MZ2. Similarly, MZ1 and MZ2 total is again 0. Here, half plus half, this total MZ is 1. This is the energy level diagram. These are all 0 and each is separated by one quantum of energy. Of course, if you go more into the details, there is a slight difference between these two. We will not worry. We say it is 0 for your understanding, it is enough. So, they are equal. But the same thing, it is homonuclear. Both are protons I am taking. What happens if I take heteronuclear? If the interacting two spins, here 1 and 2, if it is instead of proton, one is proton, other is carbon, then what is going to happen? Let us understand that. And this is the energy level. Something very interesting. Why it changed so much? Look at this energy level. Look at this energy level. Everything is same. As far as the orientation of nuclear spin, magnetic moment is concerned, in this energy state, both are down. Both are down. Up and down. Down and up, up, up. Everything is same. But why did I write like this? Why not like this? What is so speciality about heteronuclear spin? You must remember one thing. This is alpha, beta and beta alpha states are nearly same. and it's all separated by one quantum of energy, it's fine. But in this case, alpha beta and beta alpha are substantially different. Why? Because remember, this to this is homonuclear, like this, very large. This to this is homonuclear, whereas between this energy separation is heteronuclear, like carbon. What is the energy of Gallium magnet ratio of carbon when compared to proton? It is 4 times less. Remember, I have been teaching you, it is 4 times less. If this separation, let us say, is 8, some unit for proton, this carbon separation has to be 2. It's 4 times less. That is the reason why this clearly tells me this is the energy separation for carbon 13 spins. This is the energy separation for carbon 13. And these two are proton transition. This gives you proton transitions. This gives you carbon transition. The energy separation deliberately I wrote much smaller than this one, because this energy separation of carbon split, carbon energy separation between two states is much less compared to proton, 4 times smaller. That's how I represented this heteronuclear energy level. Two energy levels correspond to protons, or transitions are larger. Two energy levels which are corresponding to carbon are smaller. What do you understand by this? We'll come to that later. This tells me about a lot about intensity, everything later. We'll come to that. But this is just to give you an idea. When you want to write down the homonuclear state energy states, we write like this. For heteronuclear, we write like this. When I discuss NOE, all these things are important. Please remember, one of the classes I'll come to NOE, I will have to understand, teach you all those things. Now, four energy states of two spins will start. Let us see what will happen if I see this thing. Okay. So, these are the four energy states of two spins. Exactly. Delta sigma of mi, mz for this one, mz for this one, a and b. This is 0, this is 0, 1 and minus 1 and plus 1. This you should never forget. I keep on using these four energy states for two coupled spins very often in my talks, if not now, after some time. So these four energy states for two coupled spins are very important. Remember, always two up, two down, up, down, up, down, down, up. This is minus 1, 0, 0, plus 1. These energy states and spin orientations are important. Now, we consider two important situations, very important situations. I said two spins are interacting. That's also correct. Interacting means there is a way. I explained to you in the, when I gave the salient points of coupling. When two spins are coupled, I express its coupling strength in terms of Hertz. I use the notation J. So between two protons, A and X here, let us say this is A and this is X. When I have to calculate the J coupling, I represent this as J AX, coupling between A and X. When two protons are coupling, there are two possibilities. The coupling can be zero. Who says coupling should always be there? They may be coupled, but coupling is very small or negligible or zero. It's called uncoupled spins. Coupling is zero for in case of two spins. Or coupling can be non-zero. Remember the point. Coupling can be zero or non-zero. Non-zero means it could be minus or plus. I don't care. I just take magnitude. The coupling in this case, one possibility is uncoupled. They need not be coupled. They can be simply there without interaction. Or they can interact with the coupling strength of Jx, which is non-zero. You're all with me, I hope. Okay. Now consider a situation of one possibility. How many transitions you get in two uncoupled spin of nuclei? Please understand this point. I am considering two spins which are coupled, for which we wrote energy level diagram. Now I will put a condition, JAX is equal to 0. Remember, JAX is 0. And they are non-equivalent nuclei. They are different chemically. They are different. Chemically inequivalent spins. Means chemical shift of one proton and other protons are not same. They are different. This is the condition I am putting. They are chemically inequivalent spins. At the same time, the coupling is zero. This is one of my conditions. Let us see in this situation how many peaks I expect. It is very interesting. From the energy level diagram, you can get an information about the possible transitions. How many transitions you get in 2 spins, 3 spins like that. Of course, you don't go and do for 4 spins, 10 spins like that. After some time, it will become cumbersome. Okay? It's not easy to go beyond 2 or 3 spins. So, you can get analytical solution up to maximum 2 spins or 3 spins. Beyond that, it is very difficult. But, now the energy level diagram, let us try to understand and see how many peaks we are going to see. You are all with me, I hope. Now go back to my energy states. This is our which spins? Homonuclear spins. Now, we have 4 possible energy states. What is the magnetic energy of this state? -1. Both are negative, half of, minus of, plus of, minus of, this is 0. This is 0, minus of, plus 1, plus 1, plus of, plus 1. So, these are the possible orientations. Now, you remember what was my condition of selection rule. In one of the classes, when I was talking about the fundamentals or basics of NMR, when you try to see the signal, I introduced what is called selection rules. What is the selection rule in NMR? Okay. The change in the MI of each energy, between 2 energy states. Change in magnetic quantum number MI for each energy state, if you take between the energy state, what is the change? If it is +1 or -1, it is an allowed transition. Don't forget my selection rule which I told you. The selection rule is find out the total magnetic moment or of magnetic quantum number of each energy state. What is the magnetic quantum number of this state? Find out what is the magnetic quantum number of this state and all the 4 states. Now, find out what are the allowed transitions. Allowed transition is change in the total magnetic quantum number between 2 energy states must be +1 or -1. Remember this point. So now, let us look at the diagram. What are allowed transitions? Can we allow this transition? -1 to 0? Of course it is allowed. Because -1 to 0, the change is only -1. If you go from 0 to -1, +1. So, it is an allowed transition. What about this one? 0 to -1, -1 to 0. Allowed transition. What about this one? 0 to +1? Of course, yes. If it comes, it is -1. If you go this way, it is +1. That is allowed. Same way here. 0 and 1. Of course, it is allowed. This is, if you go this way, it is 1. If you come this way, it is -1. Fine. So, how many transitions we can get? There are 4 possible transitions where the change in the magnetic quantum number of each energy state, if you take between the 2 energy states, it should be +1 or -1. Look at this one. Now, let us see what are the transitions. Beauty is, if you identify this magnetic moment of each spin, whether it is plus or minus, plus half or minus half, you can even identify the transitions corresponding to the particular spin. Very interesting, is it not? Look at it. Of the 4 energy levels, I can say if there is a transition here, 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 allowed as per the selection rule, I can say whether it corresponds to spin A or it corresponds to spin X. It's possible. I can say that. How? Look at it very carefully. What is this transition? What is happening here? Look at carefully. The beta spin of A came to alpha spin, alpha of A went to beta A. It's allowed. +1 to -1, right? 0 to -1 is allowed. So, it's a 0 quantum. The change in the spin quantum number, where one of the spin is changing its state from alpha to beta, or beta to alpha is allowed. And which spin is changing its state? A of alpha of A is going to beta of A. And beta of A is coming to alpha of A. So, this transition must be corresponding to A. Similarly, this cannot undergo. See, X cannot undergo. Because both are beta, beta, minus of, so that cannot take place. It has to be only alpha spin. A spin is changing its state from alpha. It has to flip. One of the spin has to flip from alpha to beta or beta to alpha. Here, both are beta, beta. There is no question of X spin flipping in this energy level. You understand? In between these two energy states, beta will not flip. It cannot go from alpha to beta, beta to alpha like here. If you are both are in beta state, it remains like that. Are you all with me? Please follow me carefully. In this case, A spin can change from alpha to beta and beta to alpha. The allowed transition, I will say this is A transition. X is not possible here. You see, this is A transition. X is not possible here. Now, that is allowed. That is A transition. What about this one? Here also, alpha A is going to beta A came to alpha A. Again, plus 1 to 0 is allowed transition. So, this is what? Again, it is an A transition. Okay, this is an A transition. Now, you identify two A transitions. What are the next allowed transitions? Here, 0 to 1 is allowed. But here, beta is, A is not changing its state. A is still remaining as beta. Whatever X, X is changing from alpha to beta or beta to alpha. You understand? So, what is this transition? This is X transition. Fantastic, you know. We could even identify the transitions. Normally, what do people do? Take the NMR spectrum, start interpreting peaks. Which is CA3, which is CH2, which is aromatic. Fine. That's one way. But now, you can even identify the transition coming from a particular spin. Okay, what is next allowed? Think carefully. Now, what about this transition? This alpha. Okay, this is allowed. A was done. Now, this one. Alpha of X can go to beta of X. But alpha of A remains same here. That will not flip. So, in this transition, A is not flipping. But B is flipping. I'm sorry, X is flipping. Fantastic. So, what is this transition? Next transition. You're all with me. See, very carefully. Understand now. I'm going to tell you again. Transition from this state to this state is allowed. Where A spin is going from alpha to beta. Coming from beta to alpha. X spin cannot flip here. Because both are in the beta state. That is not allowed. This is A transition. What about this one? Alpha of A is going to beta A and beta A is coming to alpha A. That is allowed. That is A transition. This alpha X can go to beta X can come to alpha X. But here A will not undergo transition because both are beta. That is X transition. What about this? Alpha X can go to beta X can come to alpha X. But this both are in A. Up. There is no A transition here. This is X transition. So how many transitions you got? Four transitions. But what are the frequencies? This energy is exactly same as this energy. This energy is exactly same as this energy. What does it mean? Frequency of this A and frequency of this A transitions are identical. There is no separation at all. They will overlap one over the other. Though there are two A transitions, because their frequencies are not different, they overlap and you reach a single peak. Please understand me. There is no energy separation between this transition. Let us say, if the energy separation was this much, this was larger like this, then they have different energy separation, the frequencies will be different. Then they will come at different places in the NMR spectrum. But now, the energy separation is exactly identical. So, the transition frequency is exactly same. So, they overlap. Both A will overlap and give rise to single peak. Similarly, look at the x transition here. And x transition here. Exactly, both of them have the same energy separation, same frequency. What does it mean? X transitions also will overlap like this. So, please understand, in the non-interacting spins, two spins, there are four energy states. But it so happens, there are two A transitions and two X transitions. However, the frequencies of two transitions of A are identical and give rise to only one peak. They overlap. Still, there are four transitions. But in the spectrum, you observe two peaks because two are overlapping in A and two are overlapping similarly in X. The four peaks appear as two peaks for you because of overlap of 2A and overlap of 2X transition. And this is the type of spectrum you get. Two peaks for A with identical frequency, two peaks for X with identical frequency, uses a singlet for A and singlet for X, one peak. Singlet means one peak. So, assuming proton A is more shielded than proton B. What do you mean by that? Proton A is more shielded means it comes high field. And X is less shielded. So, it comes down field. So, chemical shift of X is larger than chemical shift of A when expressed in ppm. So, delta of X is larger than delta of A. That is my assumption. It need not be true. I am assuming. It can be other way also. So, just for understanding purpose, there are two peaks we are getting at two different places. And this is one peak for X, in reality two overlapped peaks for X and two overlapped peaks for A, and delta of X, by my assumption, is larger than A. So, A comes at down, X comes at down field compared to A, which comes at high field. Fantastic, is it not? So beautifully you can understand how the lines are coming when two spins are coupled. It's a simple example I took to show you that we get four peaks, two of which are overlapped when the couplings are zero in two weakly coupled AX spin system. What is weakly coupled? The word I'm using, just a jargon, don't worry. I'll discuss more about strong and weakly coupling in one of these classes. Very important to understand this spectrum. I'll come to that later. But here, for today, I just wanted to tell you what happens when two spins are coupled, how the splitting comes, what are the energy states, and what is the magnetic quantum number of each energy state, which you have to add up based on the magnetic quantum number of individual spins, and then get the magnetic quantum number for each energy state, find out its. So, apply the selection rule, find out which are the allowed transitions. A classic example which I took, where two protons are not coupled, are coupled with JAX equal to 0, non-interacting spins, I think. In which case, you get four transitions allowed, two for A and two for X, which are overlapped. And this is the spectrum. So, in this spectrum, you will not get information about J coupling, which is 0. If it is a J coupling, it should have been split into two peaks. It is not happening. So, J coupling is 0. Here also it is 0. But chemical shifts are different. Otherwise, it would have been equivalent spin system. So, it is different. So, I will get chemical shift information in this case and a chemical shift information for this spin in this case, but no coupling information. I hope you are all with me. Today, I tried to start with giving you more about the splitting and some examples of how splitting occurs when two spins are interacting, everything. Okay. So, with this, we'll stop for today and we'll come back tomorrow, where I'll take an example of the same two spins where coupling is non-zero. Another interesting example. Then how many peaks I get? That we'll understand. So, we'll come back tomorrow.